A very good morning to one and all gathered over here for this webinar on this Saturday morning. This webinar series was particularly designed for our lockdown period 2.0, wherein we felt that we'll have to come up with something productive and effective for the members as well as all our viewers. So we as a branch and committee felt that let us come up with a series of webinar for all our members, and hence we had come up with a webinar, this YouTube page of ours, Mangalore Brand, wherein we have got tremendous response from all people around. And today we have about 900 subscribers to this page. Moving forward, it was all started last Monday, wherein an open interaction by myself was taken up as a general session. Thereafter, we have had 8 technical sessions. And today, this Saturday, we are at the last 5 hours of our ODI innings. As the session all belongs to cricket, I will speak in terms of cricketing sense, wherein we are at the last power play and we have an eminent personality, an international speaker, a versatile orator and a multi-faceted person who will handle the session and is all set to hit sixes today. This morning we have with us our resource person, Dr. Rajesh Nayak from Muscat, as well as our chairman of the brand, CSS Nayak sir. I request our chairman to welcome the resource person as well as the viewers, as well as to introduce the resource person to all the gathering. Over to you, sir.
Good morning, my member friends, students, and well-wishers. Good morning to all of you. Even though it is a weekend, we can't. Which is the weekend and which is the week beginning for the last 40-45 days because of the lockdown 1 and lockdown 2, to our surprise or as per our expectation itself. So lockdown 3 will be also introduced from 3rd May. So leaving joke apart, today being the 8th technical webinar hosted by the Mangalore branch of Chartered Accountants of India, we have great orator and renowned speaker from abroad, from Muscat. First time we are introducing international speaker to all of you. So Dr. Rajesh Nayak. Dr. Rajesh Nayak, I can tell him he is a friend for me. When I requested him to render his topic, he told the very interesting topic, management lessons from cricketing history. You may be surprised whether he is with the cricket background. So if I explain his biodata, you will be stunned. I will definitely want to make you stunned. Rajesh is an all-rounder, academician, trainer, banker, cricket lover, music lover, film lover, what not. Life gives two gifts. One is chance, another is the choice. The chance to meet many friends and choice to select the best ones as friends for life. Dr. Rajesh is my best friend. I am proud to tell you. Opportunities are equal to all. Successful person gives results, whereas unsuccessful person gives reasons. It is applicable to Dr. Rajesh Nayak. Why he is so successful, I will read his brief biodata but in nutshell, but it is still 2 pages, but I want to brief. Dr. K. Rajesh Nayak is Director Training at College of Banking and Financial Studies, CBFS, short for Muscat, Sultanate of Oman, which is under the Central Bank of Oman, the banking regulator of Oman. CBFS is the sponsor of the Muscat chapter of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, and Dr. Rajesh oversees the sponsorship. He has over 2 decades of experience in training innumerable executives and staff of banks in India, Oman, UAE, etc. His academic qualifications, people should listen each and every properly, become Mangalore University first rank with gold medal, MCom, Mangalore University first rank with gold medal, MBA Mangalore University first rank with gold medal, LLB Mangalore University first rank in first year, CIIB, the Indian Institute of Banking and Finance, second rank all India level, PG Diploma in Marketing and Sales Management from Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, that is first rank with gold medal at all India level, PG Diploma in Personal Management, Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, first rank with gold medal at all India level, PhD in Business Administration from Mangalore University, which he has completed within a record time of 3 years. Professional milestones. He also holds various professional certificates, including Omega Credit Skills Development, Creative Train the Trainer, NLP for Trainers, Certificate in Training Evaluation, Islamic Finance Qualification, International Certificate in Wealth and Investment Management of CISI UK, Certificate of Occupational Assessment from British Psychological Society, and Advanced Diploma in Credit from Chartered Institute of Bankers, Scotland. He has attended executive development programs on leadership and strategy by Queen's School of Business, Canada. Prior to moving to Oman, he worked for almost a decade with Karnataka Bank, the family bank across India, our own bank of this soil. His last position being chief manager in Karnataka Bank at regional office, Mumbai. His areas of training specialization are numerable, which I don't want to read today. And present position, Director Training, College of Banking and Financial Studies under the Central Bank of Oman, Muscat. Accolades and awards, member of the Group Study Exchange team of Rotary District 3180, which visited Rotary District 3950, Rhode Island and Massachusetts, USA in the new millennium 2000. Secretary of Public Relations Society of India, Mangalore Manipal Chapter in the year 2002 when it won the Best Chapter Award at All India level. This is the brief introduction of Dr. Rajesh Naik. Many more things to tell, but I don't want to stop here. I want to say with the small Sanskrit quote regarding Dr. Rajesh Naik. वदनं प्रसाद सदनं हृदयं हृदयं सुदामुचो वाचः करणं परोपकरणं येषां केषां नते वंद्याः. The meaning of this is वदनं प्रसाद सदनं. Face is the index of mind, whose face is always smiling or shining. हृदयं हृदयं, person with good heart. सुदामुचो वाचः, so that means whose words are always pleasing words. Karanam paropakaranam, who always craves for doing good to others. Yesham natevandyaha, such people are respected by all. So with this brief introduction, Dr. Rajesh Naik, I requested, he told, even though he is from Muscat, friends, there is a saying, to a friend's house the road is never long. He always thinks, janani, even though he is at Muscat, his heart is always in Mangalore. Always, educational institutions canvas, rank reigns in their institutions. But in case of Rajesh, rank reigns at Rajesh. Whenever he tries any exam, the result is first rank to Rajesh only. He has no love for gold because he is holding many gold medals in his kitty. He may feel that the gold medals are problem of plenty. That's why he has stopped or doing additional qualifications. So over to Dr. Rajesh Naik for his very interesting, humorous and management lessons from cricketing history. Thank you, Rajesh. Over to you.
Good morning to all the intellectual leaders who are viewing this webinar. And thank you to my mentor, CSS Naik, for that warm and generous introduction. As he had mentioned, I have a close relationship with the Muscat chapter of ICAI, which has 350 plus members. The chapter is relatively young. It was founded only in 2008. And during the 12 years, it has won 5 times the Overseas Chapters Award of ICAI, including the best overseas chapter in category 2 for 2 consecutive years. Also, an interesting point to note is, from diversity point of view, out of its 12 chairpersons, 25%, that is three chairpersons, including the current chairperson, have been ladies. So this is in brief about the chapter. Now, coming to my presentation, just a couple of points which I would like to share before starting. One is, despite our best efforts, due to some technical issue, we could not manage to enable the sound in some of the videos. So we will be playing the videos without sound, but I will be adding my hopefully value-added comments during the course of the videos. The second thing is that I will have several questions for you during the presentation, and you can use the chat facility to answer, and I will try my best to acknowledge the correct answers. Okay, so with this, we are ready to start. And CA Gautam Pai will be assisting me in the presentation, and I would request him to show the first slide. This is the cover of one of the best books ever written on cricket, Beyond a Boundary by CLR James, which contains that sentence on page 32, which is shown in the slide. It indicates that cricket means different things to different people. It is a sport, it is a passion, it is a science, it's an art, it's an industry, it's a livelihood. And even to those who are mathematically inclined, like chartered accountants, it can be described as a mathematical abstraction of initials, averages, decimals, and records. John Fowles describes cricket as a beautiful and highly stylized form of medieval warfare, combining proud chivalry with greed. In fact, just to give you an idea of how, you know, cricket can sometimes convey different things to those who do not follow it, an expectant father in Britain was ringing the hospital, and by accident he ended up dialing the Lord's cricket ground. And when the receiver was lifted, he asked, "How's it going?" He thought he's speaking to the doctor. The reply was, "We have three out and hope to have the rest out before lunch. And the last one was a duck." Next slide, please. Next slide, please. The origin of cricket in the 1700s in Britain, among shepherds, with two stumps and a stick on top of it, resembling the gate of a shepherd's pen, with the shepherd's crook as a bat and matted wool bound with hide of leather as a ball. In 1776, Lumpy Stevens of Kent bowled the batsman John Small of Hambledon in a match of 5 of Hambledon versus 5 of Kent. He bowled him twice through the stumps, but both times the batsman was adjudged not out, as the ball did not disturb the stumps or touch the stumps on either side. Having received this reprieve, John Small scored the 18 runs required for a win for Hambledon. Both sides agreed after the match that this rule had been unduly harsh, and hence in 1776, the third stump or the middle stump was added. The second photograph shows the headquarters of the Bat and Ball Club at Hambledon Inn, where most of the early rules of cricket were framed. Next, please. Next slide, please. Yes. The early laws of cricket were framed in 1744 by a group of noblemen and gentlemen who played cricket in the Artillery Ground of London. Following the formation of the Marylebone Cricket Club, or the MCC, in 1787, the lawmaking function in cricket passed to the MCC. The laws were amended several times in 1835, 1884, 1947, and 1980. In the year 2000, a preamble was added to the laws, which contains many words linked to management, as you can see in the display on the slide. The highlighted words are all linked to management. A completely new law was adopted in the year 2017, and again it was updated in 2019. So you can see that the laws of cricket contain several references to the principles of management such as leadership, friendship, teamwork, etc. Next slide, please. Now we will take up each management principle and I will demonstrate it with a cricketing example. Since most of the viewers are chartered accountants, I will quote numbers at the appropriate places. The first principle, tough times do not last, tough people do. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. The first hero of Test cricket was an Australian bowler named Frederick Spofforth. He took 14 for 90 in the Oval Test of 1882 to take Australia to a nail-biting 7-run win. In fact, the finish was so tantalizing that one spectator was carried off the field dead due to cardiac arrest while watching the match, and another insisted that he had gnawn off the ends of his umbrella handle while watching the match. The scores: Australia 63 and 122, England 101 and 77. Next slide, please. The next day, this ad was inserted in the obituaries column of the Sunday Times by an English cricket lover with a sense of humor. It was in remembrance of English cricket, which supposedly died the previous day. And see the footnote at the end. The body will be cremated and the ashes taken to Australia. Now, a question to all the distinguished viewers through the chat, could you tell me what this ad eventually led to? Anybody would like to guess based on that last sentence, the body will be cremated and the ashes taken to Australia. Could you tell me what this led to? Well, I don't see any answers. It led to what you see in the next slide, please. Yes, I see an answer here from Mangalore ICI. It says the rivalry of the ashes. Perfect. That's the right answer. It led to the institution of a trophy between England and Australia for the test series played between them, which came to be known as the Ashes. In the following year, 1883, England toured Australia. And in the third test at Melbourne, a group of Victorian ladies burnt a cricket bale, put it in an urn and presented it to the Honorable Ivo Bligh, who was captaining the English cricket team. Upon his death in 1927, Ivo Bligh bequeathed it to the cricket stadium of ICC at Lord's, where it stands to this day. The trophy remains there irrespective of who wins the test series, and what is awarded to the captain of the winning team at the end of the test series is only a replica. Next slide, please. Can anyone tell me which test match does this picture depict? One of the most famous test matches in history. Only the third time that a team had won a test match after following on. You would know that following on means a team having batted second bats again if its deficit with the first inning score of the opposite team is more than 200 runs in a 5-day test. And if the test is cut short to 4 days, the deficit gets reduced to 150 runs. I already, I think, see an answer here from Naveen Kumar. He says, Kolkata, which year and between whom? Naveen Kumar, can you build up upon that? Anybody? Yes, Kolkata test. Mangalore ICI is right. Between? Well, again, Mangalore ICI and Damodar Shene, India versus Australia, that's right. The famous Kolkata test of 2001 between India and Australia, only the third time that a team had won after following on, and in all three cases the loser was Australia. I'm sure viewers would remember Australia batted first and the captain Steve Waugh scored 100 and they made 445 all out. Harbhajan Singh took 6 for 123. In reply, India bundled out for 171, and then following on were 232 for 4 when Rahul Dravid joined VVS Lakshman at the crease. What followed was a massive 376 run partnership for the fifth wicket which enabled India to declare at 657/7. And then again, with the help of Harbhajan Singh, 6/73, Australia were bundled out for 212, leaving India victor by 171 runs. The other two instances where teams had won after following on, England versus Australia at Sydney in 1894. England scored 526 and 166. Australia scored 325 and 437. I'm sorry, it was the opposite. It was Australia who scored 586 and 166, and England scored 325 and 437. And then, of course, the 1981 Headingley Test between England and Australia at Leeds. Australia scored 401 for 9. England batting scored 174. Ian Botham just stripped off his captaincy, returning to form with 50. And then following on, England were 174 for 6 when Ian Botham played one of the greatest test innings of 149 not out. And with the help of Graham Dilley, 56, and Chris Holder, 29, took England to 356. Needing 129 to win, Australia was seemingly coasting to victory at 56 for 1 when John Dyson, who had scored a century in the first innings, was out for 34. And then the collapse started, and stunningly, Australia slipped to 111 all out, leaving England victor by 18 runs. This was one of the greatest fightbacks ever scripted in Test cricket, showing that you never lost a battle till the last ball is bowled. Next, please. Success is the outcome of self-confidence, determination, and hard work. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Well, you see here three cricketers. Can anyone name all three of them? I'm looking at the chat. Can anyone name all the three cricketers featured in this photograph? No, I guess the ones on the sides. Yes, it's Mangalore ICI once again. Starting from left to right, Shane Warne in the extreme left, Sachin Tendulkar, our brand man, to the extreme right, and in the middle, you have the epitome of perfection in cricket, Sir Donald George Bradman. For the benefit of chartered accountants, let me share some numbers about Donald Bradman. He played in 52 tests, 80 innings, of which 10 he remained not out, so 70 completed innings. He scored 6,996 runs with a batting average of 99.94, which is one of the records most unlikely to be equaled in Test cricket. He scored 29 Test hundreds and 13 Test 50s. Out of those 29 centuries, 10 were double hundreds and 2 were triple hundreds. The double hundreds included a 299 not out against South Africa when he ran out of partners. The innings was completed. And guess what was the secret of his perfection in batting? His habit of practicing as a young schoolboy by hitting a golf ball against a garden wall, not with a bat, but with a single cricketing stump. Bradman's career was cruelly cut short in between 1939 and 1945, which would have been his most productive years as a batsman, between the age of 31 and 37, due to World War II, between 1939 and 1945. Had Bradman played cricket in those years, it is mind-boggling to think what his statistics would have been. Now we will capture a moment, you know, towards the end of Bradman's career. The pinnacle of Bradman's career was when he led a team to England in 1948. His declared ambition before the start of the tour was to beat England in England. His team did so well, winning 4 out of the 5 tests with 1 test drawn, that they earned the sobriquet the Invincibles. The team boasted of several great players such as Lindsay Hassett, the vice captain, Ray Lindwall, the world's fastest bowler, Keith Miller, the mercurial all-rounder, Neil Harwit, the left-handed batsman, Sam Loxton, Arthur Morris and Sid Barnes, the best opening pair, Don Tallon, the world's best wicketkeeper, and so on. The Oval Test, began with England being bundled out for 52 on the first day, with Rail Indwall taking 6 for 20. Australia had lost their first wicket when Bradman arrived at the crease to play what was to be his last test innings. He just required to score 4 in that last innings to make his test batting average a perfect 100. But let's see what happened. Video, please. Bradman walked out to a standing ovation from the crowd at the Oval. He also received a cap sub from the team. The first ball was played defensively to Silly Point. The second ball, a googly, deceived him. And you can see his bails getting disturbed as he was bowled. He turned away and walked off again to a standing ovation. It's not often that a batsman walks off to a standing ovation after scoring 0. But then this moment was different. It was the curtains coming down on the most brilliant test cricketing career in history. Just a question now here for the intellectual leaders viewing this. Can anyone tell me the name of that bowler who carved his name forever in cricketing history by clean bowling Sir Donald Bradman for a second ball duck? Anyone? Well, it seems the answer is not yet coming. The bowler who clean bowled Bradman second ball for a duck in his last test innings to limit his test average to 99.94, perhaps God's way of reminding Bradman that after all, he's a mortal. Yes, I see the right answer from Prashant Kamath. He has mentioned it as Eric Hollis. That's right. Eric Hollis claimed 5 for 131 in the Australian innings of 389. And then England were bundled out for 188 in the second innings, leaving Australia victor by an innings and 149 runs with 2 out of the 5 days to spare. The test match got over in 3 days. Okay, Prashant Kamath has given the right answer. It is Eric Hollis. Next slide, please. Bradman also wrote 2 accomplished books. One was his autobiography titled Farewell to Cricket, which shows a fascinating journey of the cricketing world of his time. And the second one was a manual for aspiring young cricketers called The Art of Cricket. Next slide, please. It's a game, not a war. Remember, cricket owes much of its importance to the spirit with which it is played. Next slide, please. The left person in the frame is India-born Douglas Jardine, who was appointed captain of the English team to tour Australia in 1932. His main worry was how to curb the prolific run scoring of Bradman. In the previous test series in England in 1930, Don Bradman was at the peak of his prowess, scoring 974 runs in 5 tests, including 2 triple centuries. But amidst all that, there was one moment which Jardine carefully remembered. In the 5th test at the Oval on the 3rd day, when the wicket was damp due to rain the previous evening, the ball was bouncing unevenly and Bradman looked distinctly uncomfortable and more mortal than any time in his career till then. Jardine carefully noted this and took in his team to Australia in 1932 5 fast bowlers: Harold Larwood, whom you see there in the right photograph, Bill Voss, Gubby Allen and Maurice Tate. The objective was to follow a strategy called leg theory, that is, have a field setting of 7 fieldsmen on the leg side in a circle and 2 fieldsmen on the right, and of course the wicketkeeper behind the stumps, and then have the fast bowlers bowl very fast on a leg stump line at the body of the bowler, of the batsman. Very often, the batsman who was unnerved, remember in those days there was no protective gear like helmets and so on, the batsman used to get unnerved at this targeted bowling towards his body and give a catch to one of the 6 fieldsmen who were waiting for the catch on the leg side like birds of prey. Next slide, please. Here you see the leg theory fielding. You can see 6 of the 7 fieldsmen on the leg side and 1 fieldsman on the off side. And what was the result of this? Bradman's test average used to slip to 56.57, which was the lowest ever test average that he had in any series. He could score only one century in the series, that is in the second test. Australian captain Bill Woodfull was hit on the heart by a bouncer from Harold Larwood. And in the next slide, you can see, next slide, please. Australian batsman Bert Oldfield was hit by another bouncer from Harold Larwood. When the English captain Pelham Warner visited the Australian dressing room to inquire about the health of Australian captain Woodfull, who was hit on the heart, Woodfull replied, "There are two sides out there. One is playing cricket and the other isn't." The next day, this statement was leaked to the Australian press by an unknown Australian cricketer who was in the dressing room. And Australian cricket writer Ray Robinson coined a new term for this leg theory, which was more catchy. He called it bodyline. And you would, of course, remember the BBC serial on this bodyline series. An Australian press journalist described this as warfare on the cricketing field. It was held to be against the spirit of cricket. And after the series ended, the laws of cricket were amended to make bodyline bowling illegal. Harold Larwood took 33 wickets in the test series, but then he never played again for England. He migrated to Australia in the 1950s, where he eventually died at the age of 77. Next slide, please. Play the game with a straight bat. Next slide, please. The year was 1961. But before that, let me show you this picture. A great Indian test batsman who played only 10 tests and scored 859 runs between 1936 and 1945. His first class batting average of 71.14 was second only to Sir Donald Bradman. He used to play for Bombay in the Pentangulars and the Ranji Trophy. Can anyone name this great Indian batsman? I see an answer from Mr. Hari Holda called Ranjit Singh. No, it's not the Jam Sahib of Nawanagar, Ranjit Singhji. Ranjit Singhji never played in the Ranji Trophy, although it was named after him. He played test cricket for England and India. Anybody else? Let me give you a clue. His surname has a commercial tone to it. Chartered Accountants, that should give you some idea. No, I do not see any answers here. His name is Vijay Merchant. Vijay Merchant was considered as one of the best batsmen of India during the 30s and 40s. But again, the Second World War caused him to lose 6 prime years of his career. Later on, he went on to become chairman of selectors, about which I will speak later, how he played a key role in resurrecting India's test fortunes. But Vijay Merchant is remembered for coining that famous sentence, "When the greatest scorer of them all writes against your name, he will not write whether you won or lost, but how you played the game." This was Vijay Merchant's famous quotation. And I see an answer from Jairam Shani. It's come a bit late. He has said that it is Merchant. That's right. Okay. Yes. Next slide, please. The year was 1961. And while India and Pakistan were playing a most boring test series with all the tests being drawn, elsewhere, Australia and the West Indies were collaborating for what is regarded as perhaps the most exciting test series of all time. And you can see the two captains of Australia and West Indies in the photograph. Can anybody identify either or both of them? Anybody? The man on the left is the Australian captain. You have seen him several times on Channel 9. He became a very prolific cricket commentator. Well, Mr. Hari Holda has again got it right. He's obviously referring to the man on the right. It's Sir Frank Mortimer Maglin Worrell. That's right, Mr. Holda. It is Frank Worrell. What about the man on the left? Well, Vinod Rajamani says Sobers. I'm afraid Vinod, Sobers did play in that series, but under the captaincy of Worrell for the West Indies. Okay, so that's not Sobers. Sir Garfield Sobers played in that series, but under the captaincy of Sir Frank Worrell. Anybody about the man on the left? Gautam Naik, has got it 50% right. He's got the first name right. Gautam, that's fair enough. You are right. It is Richie Benaud, the Australian captain who later became a celebrated commentator on Channel 9. Okay. They played very tough cricket, but very fair cricket. And it every test match was exciting. The first test at Brisbane was the tight test. Both the teams tied the scores. Nobody won, nobody lost. The second test, which was played at Melbourne, Australia won by 7 wickets. The third test at Sydney, West Indies won by 222 runs. The fourth test at Adelaide, on the last day, Australia needed 186 to win. The last wicket pair was at the crease with 1.5 hours to go. Worrell was smelling victory. But then the last pair, Ken Mackay and Lindsay Klin, hung on not to get out for the next 1.5 hours, which converted the test to a draw. And then in an equal nail-biting finish in the repeat test, the fifth test at Melbourne, Australia went on to win by 2 wickets. So the series ended 2-1 in Australia's favour, although it could just as easily have gone the West Indian way. The Australian crowd so much admired Sir Frank Worrell and the way he led the team with dignity and decorum both on and off the field that the Australian Cricket Board instituted the trophy which you can see in the photograph called the FM Worrell Trophy for the test series between Australia and the West Indies. And the trophy was handed over by Sir Frank Worrell himself to Richie Benaud, the captain of the winning side. Next slide, please. This is the magic moment, the last wicket dismissal in the tight test at Brisbane. You can see the last batsman, Lindsay Klin, being run out by a direct throw from the West Indian fieldsman, Joe Solomon. Just for trivia, Joe Solomon was the manager of the West Indian cricket team later that toured India under Alvin Kalicharan's captaincy in 1978. So Lindsay Klin run out by Joe Solomon. And the scores were Australia, in fact, you know, scored 450. In fact, West Indies scored 453 and 284. And Australia scored 505 and 232. So both the teams scored 737 runs. In the tight test at Brisbane. Of course, later on, there was a second tight test. You would remember that the Madras test between India and Australia in 1986. Okay. Yes. Next slide, please. This was the Australian public's way of saying farewell to Worrell, a motorcade after the series as they went to the airport to fly back to the West Indies with ticker tape lined on both sides of the streets and the crowds lined up to bid farewell to Sir Frank Worrell and his team. Definitely the best spirit of cricket. Next slide, please. What is little known is that Sir Frank Worrell actually acted in a Hindi film. He made a guest appearance in India's first 70mm film shot in Technicolor. Just to give you a clue, the film starred the showman Raj Kapoor and the heroine was Rajashree, daughter of movie mogul V. Shantaram. The title song of the film began with the line, Duniya ki sair kar lo. The year was 1967. The movie was shot in 1966 and Worrell acted in it in a brief guest appearance. By the time it was released in 1967, Worrell was tragically dead due to leukemia at the young age of 42. Can anyone tell me what is the name of that film in which Worrell made a guest appearance? You can see here Worrell with the famous comedian Om Prakash. Can anyone tell me the name of this movie, 1967? Raj Kapoor, Rajashree, title song, Duniya Ki Sair Kar Lo. Again, well, Mr. Hariholla seems to be dominating the conversation these days. Excellent, Mr. Hariholla. Original title was Around the World, not in 80 days, that is Jackie Chan. It was Around the World in $8, but later the title was cut short to Around the World. Okay, so you can see there, approximately after 1 hour in the film, you can see the guest appearance by Sir Frank Worrell. And Worrell even had a currency issued with his face on it, which is a rare tribute to any cricketer. And as long as cricket continues, the name of Sir Frank Worrell will epitomize the best and the most positive spirit of the game. Next slide, please. This was another great gesture by our own Karnataka's little master. I'm sure all of you remember him, Gundappa Ranganath Vishwanath, G.R. Vishwanath. This happened in the Jubilee Test of 1980 between India and England. India had batted first, of course, at Bombay Wankhede Stadium and scored 242. And in reply, England were 58 for 5. And then Bob Taylor joined Ian Botham at the crease. And when the score was 85, Bob Taylor appeared to have sneaked a delivery from Kapil Dev to the wicketkeeper Syed Kirmani. And the umpire raised his finger. Taylor believed that he had not touched the ball with the bat. And seeing his doubts or body language of disapproval, Gundappa Vishwanath went up to him and asked him whether the bat had touched the ball or not. And when Taylor replied in the negative, Gundappa Vishwanath requested the umpire to cancel his decision and recall Bob Taylor to continue his innings at the crease. Well, this proved to be very costly for India. Bob Taylor and Ian Botham put on 149 runs for the sixth wicket. Ian Botham scored 114 while Bob Taylor scored 43. And then Ian Botham went on to take 7 for 48 in the Indian second innings to add to his first innings tally of 6 for 58. So Ian Botham had a rare double of a century and more than 10 wickets in a match, 114 and 13 for 106. And India lost the test match by 10 wickets. But Gundappa Vishwanath was acclaimed throughout the cricketing world for his gesture, which epitomized the spirit of cricket. Next slide, please. Well, Mr. Harihalla, just a correction. It was not the captain. Okay. Bob Taylor was not the captain. Bob Taylor was not the captain. He was the wicketkeeper in that test match. Okay, for England. Yes. Never underestimate or provoke others. Let your words speak for you. Next slide, please. The year was 1976. And the test series was due to be played between the visiting West Indian cricket team against the English side who were playing their home series. Can anyone name these two captains of England and the West Indies respectively? Excellent Mangalore ICI has identified the person on the right. It is Clive Hubert Lloyd, who was in the Queen's Honours list and was knighted in 2020, along with another West Indian cricketer, Gordon Greenidge. Okay, so he's now Sir Clive Lloyd. And the man on the left, Naveen Kumar K, has also added Clive Lloyd. That's right. What about the man on the left? 6 feet 7.5 inches, the second tallest cricketer in history. South African born who played for England. Well, no answers forthcoming. It's Anthony Gregg, known as Tony Gregg. Okay, just to tell you a background of this series. Before this series, India under Bishan Bedi's captaincy had toured the West Indies. At Port of Spain, India had successfully chased 402 to win. Sunil Gavaskar scored 102, Gundappa Vishwanath scored 112, Mohinder Amarnath scored 85, and the winning runs were hit by our very own Karnataka's Brijesh Patel, who scored 49 not out. Clive Lloyd was very angry with the spinners for having failed to bowl India out on a turning pitch on the last day at Port of Spain. So he decided henceforth to fall back on pace bowling. And with devastating results, in the last test at Kingston, the Indian innings ended at 97 for 5 because the remaining 5 batsmen were unable to bat, having been hit by Clive Lloyd's fast bowlers while batting. So Clive Lloyd had decided to rely on fast bowling as his main weapon. And in 1976, he led the West Indies team to tour England, which contained 4 fast bowlers: Andy Roberts, Michael Holding, Van Burn Holder and Wayne Daniel. Yes, here is a query from Mangalore ICI. Is he the same commentator we used to see in the last decade? Yes. You remember he used to comment when Sachin Tendulkar used to bat very well. He used to say Sachin is on fire, which used to prompt the fire brigade to send their fire engines to the stadium to douse out the fire. It's the same Tony Gregg who sadly died in 2012. Okay. So he made a comment before the series which added fuel to the fire, you know. He made a big mouth statement in an interview to BBC Sports. He said, "We will make the West Indies grovel." Grovel is a word which has racial overtones. And a South African white saying that to a West Indian black provoked the entire West Indies team. But they said, we will not reply to Tony Gregg's thoughtless words with thoughtless words. We will reply to his thoughtless words with thoughtful actions. So the English batsman found the West Indies bowlers bowling extra fast and extra menacingly whenever they were at the crease. And by the end of the series, commentators were wondering whether, you know, they were lucky that 10 English batsmen did not die during the series. In the next slide, we will show you a photograph of the battered body of one English batsman, Brian Close, who was repeatedly hit on the body by bouncers from Andy Roberts, Michael Holding, Benburn Holder and Wayne Daniel. And in the last test at the Oval, you know, the first two tests ended in a draw. West Indies won the third test at Old Trafford by 425 runs, a massive margin of 425 runs. They won the fourth test at Headingley again by 55 runs. And in the fifth test at the Oval, which was a batsman's paradise, they won by 231 runs with Michael Holding, the fast bowler known as Whispering Death, for a smooth run-up, taking 14 for 149, that is 8 for 92 and 6 for 57 in a test match where no other bowler from either side could take more than two wickets. So on a dead wicket, he bowled beautifully. And in the end, it was very clear that it was the English team and not the West Indies team which was doing the groveling at the end of the series. Okay, next slide, please. So it's always better to let actions speak louder than words. Courage in the face of adversity. Next slide, please. Can anyone tell me who are these two cricketers who are shown in the slide? Should be an easy one. Mangalore ICI is almost immediately on the spot. Yes. The photograph on the left, it's the ninth Nawab of Patodi, Mansur Ali Khan, who lost an eye in a car accident in England on 1st July 1961, but overcame it by scoring 2,793 runs in 46 tests, including 6 centuries and 16 half centuries, and a career best score of 203 not out against England at Delhi in 1963-64. But perhaps his most memorable innings was at Headingley against England in 1967. He scored 64 in the first innings and following on in the second innings made a memorable 148, which prompted the Sunday Guardian to carry the headline of the next day as "Hats off to Mansur Ali Khan, the Nawab of Headingley and of Patodi." He was also a very astute cricketing captain. And the man on the right, well, Ganesh Prasad gets it right along with Hari Holla. It is our own Karnataka's Bhagavat Subramanya Chandrasekhar, that is B.S. Chandrasekhar, who had a polio-afflicted arm, which he used to good effect to bowl a concealed googly. In the 1974-75 series, when the West Indies cricket team under Clive Lloyd toured India, in the first test at Bangalore, Chandrasekhar dismissed the great Vivian Richards, Sir Vivian Richards, who was making his debut in single figures for 6 and 5. You can see the scorecards. Very obligingly, our selectors dropped Chandrasekhar for the second test at Delhi. But even then, Vivian Richards, when he had scored just 13, gave a catch behind the wicket to Farooq Engineer of the bowling of stand-in captain Venkat Raghavan, who was substituting for Patodi, who was injured. Much to the chagrin of the Indian team, the umpire this time stepped in and gave Vivian Richards not out. And he went on to score 192 not out, and his test career was launched. Chandrasekhar took 242 test wickets, and Vivian Richards used to say his fast one is as fast as Jeff Thompson's. Okay, next slide, please. Next slide, please. Collective accountability. Next slide, please. At the turn of the 70s, in 1970, South Africa had perhaps the greatest cricketing side in history. From the left, you can see the left-handed batsman Graham Pollock, whose debut later played for South Africa, Sean Pollock. You can see Barry Richards, the great batsman, the other Richards as he was called, Mike Proctor, the mercurial all-rounder, Eddie Barlow, all-rounder, Clive Rice, all-rounder, and Vincent Vanderbilt, the 6 feet, 7 inch fast bowler. In their last test series in 1970, they whitewashed Bill Lawrie's Australian cricket team 4-0. But then England were due to visit South Africa the next year for a test series, and South Africa objected to the inclusion of a non-white cricketer named Basil de Oliveira in the English cricket team, because you would remember that apartheid was there in South Africa. Incensed by this, England initiated a move in the International Cricket Conference with the support of all other cricketing nations to ban South Africa from Test cricket, which continued for a period of 2 decades, which meant that all these great cricketing talents were lost to the world of Test cricket. They had to content themselves with playing county cricket in England. It is very interesting to think what a thriller it would have been if this great South African side could have played against Clive Lloyd's equally great West Indian side. But then they had the collective accountability for their government's action of apartheid, which continued till 1990 when Nelson Mandela removed apartheid and the first South African cricket team toured India to re-begin their test journey. Next slide, please. Change management is about taking tough decisions. The year was again 1970. Next slide, please. Vijay Merchant, as the chairman of selectors, had a tough task before him. The Indian cricket team was doing well but not winning under the captaincy of Tiger Patel. So as Vijay Merchant said, when production falls, the production manager has to be held responsible and sacked. So when the selectors met in 1970 to select the Indian team to tour the West Indies, the first proposal put forward by Vijay Merchant was to replace Tiger Patowdy with Ajit Wadekar as the captain. Although there were 5 selectors, 1 selector from Kolkata was absent, Bengal. So only 4 selectors were present. 2 selectors, including Vijay Merchant, voted for replacing Patowdy, while 2 selectors voted to retain Patowdy. Since the votes were tied, Vijay Merchant, as the chairman of selectors, had a casting vote to break the tie, which he cast in favor of replacing Patowdy, and hence Ajit Wadekar took over as the captain of India. The next day, Tiger Patowdy announced himself unavailable to be a member of the touring side to the West Indies because he was contesting for the Lok Sabha elections. So Wadekar led the team to West Indies, and India attained the distinction of winning its first ever test series against the West Indies. And there were 3 heroes in the Indian side who contributed to that victory. 2 of them are shown in the slide. Can anyone identify either or both of them? Let me give a clue each. The one on the left was the first Goan-born cricketer to play for India. And the second one on the right was the first Afghanistan-born cricketer to play for India. Naveen Kumar says Gavaskar. I'm afraid that's not Gavaskar. Okay, one more clue. The man on the left, his son, who resembles him to a great extent, is a noted TV journalist. Think of a Goan-born TV journalist and you would be able to identify his father on the left. Well, let me give you the final clue. Rajdeep's father. Can anyone name him now? His son Rajdeep. You see him often on TV. Well, in Kannada, I'm getting the answer from Ramesh KG. Danyavadagalu Ramesh Ravare. It's right. That is Dilip Sardesai. Dilip Sardesai played a monumental role in that series, scoring 642 runs in 5 tests. In the first test at Kingston, he scored 212. In the second test at Port of Spain, he scored 112. And in the 4th test at Bridgetown, he scored 150. He broke Paul Umrigar and Russi Modi's joint record of the highest series aggregate of 560 runs in 5 tests by scoring 642. But the record lasted only for 5 days because it was overtaken by another youngster playing in his first test series. The man on the right, who used to hit sixes on demand. You know, the crowd used to shout, "We want six," and he used to oblige by hitting a six into the crowd. Anyone? He also acted in a Hindi film called Charitra with Parveen Babi. Well, I don't see any answers to that. It is none other than Salim Durrani. Salim Durrani used to hit sixes on demand. And when he acted in the movie Charitra with Parveen Babi, The advertising byline for the movie was, "Come and watch sexy Parveen acting with sexy Salim." Hari Holla has now put the answer that it is Durrani. It's indeed very much correct. It is Salim Durrani. But then the limelight was stolen from both of them by a youngster who was playing in his very first test series. Having missed the first test at Kingston due to a finger injury, he made his debut at Port of Spain, scoring 65 and 67 not out. In the next test at Georgetown, he made 116 and 64 not out. In the fourth test at Bridgetown, he failed in the first inning, scoring 1, but rallied in the second innings to score 117 not out. And in the last test, the repeat test at Port of Spain, he scored a century in each innings with 124 and 220. His series aggregate being 774 runs in 4 tests, which surpassed Dilip Sardesai's 642 runs in the same series. And I can already see 3 answers even before I ask the question. Congratulations to Hari Holla, Naveen Kumar and Ramesh KG, who have all identified that youngster. You can see the next slide, please. The next slide, please. He even acted in a Marathi movie with the lady Madhumati, who is the niece of umpire Pilu reporter. Okay. So 4 test centuries in the series. And can anyone name the movie? By the way, there is a question here from P. Pai. He's asking me, do I remember the statistics or reading them? Well, Mr. Pai, you can see here, I'm looking into the screen and saying the statistics. And I can assure you our technology is not so sophisticated for me to have a teleprompter. So I am reciting them out of memory. Okay. I hope that answers the question. Okay. This is a Marathi movie. Can anyone name the movie in which this youngster acted? It is Sunil Gavaskar, by the way. Congratulations to all those who gave the correct answer, playing in his debut series. And can anyone tell the name of this Marathi movie in which Sunil Gavaskar acted? Nobody? Well, it's called Savli Premaji. Okay, so that was Sunil Gavaskar venturing into the field of acting very briefly. And he was prompted to do it by umpire Pilu reporter because he wanted a celebrity acting opposite his niece, Madhumati. Okay, next slide, please. Sunil Gavaskar was a very astute, you know, financial brain. You know, even after he retired from cricket, he ran his own professional management group. And he also wrote 5 books which are bestsellers: Sunny Days, Runs and Ruins, Idols, One Day Wonders and Straight Drive. I've read all 5 of them and would strongly recommend them to you, not only for understanding about cricket, but also various principles of strategy and management from one of the shrewdest cricketing brains that ever stepped up on a cricketing field. Thank you very much to Mr. Anil for some encouraging words. I will try my best to live up to them. Okay. Yes. Next slide, please. From the West Indies, India went on to England. The first 2 tests at Lord's and Old Trafford were drawn. At the Oval, India put in England to bat. England made 355 and India responded with 284. All of a sudden, on the 4th day, England were shot out or bundled out for 101 all out. And the architect of the victory, B.S. Chandrasekhar, who took 6 for 38. And then India successfully chased 174 with 6 wickets down to win the Oval Test and make it a rare double. After winning 1-0 in the West Indies, they beat England 1-0. This was the first time that India had beaten England in an overseas series. And you can see there on the balcony at the Oval, the victorious captain Ajit Wadekar, along with the architect of the victory, B.S. Chandrasekhar, and behind him is Dilip Sardesai, waving to the cheering crowds after the win. Okay, next slide, please. The best way to overcome prejudice is by your work. Next slide, please. Nobody epitomized this principle more than the West Indies. You know, during the 70s and much of the 80s, West Indians were kings of the cricketing world. They rode roughshod over all other opposing teams, but never once could you remember them ever using harsh language or sledging against the batsmen like the Australians used to do. They used to let their actions speak for them more than their words. And in fact, Andy Roberts used to swear that if ever he hit a batsman by his fast deliveries, he used to feel a tinge of pain in his body, and he never enjoyed a batsman getting hit by his bowling. And much of the cricket in the Caribbean was born from beach cricket. You know, many of the test cricketers emerged from beach cricket, which is played in the Caribbean, which you can see here. In fact, many of the beach cricketers have now switched to basketball, which is why cricketing talent has dried up in the West Indies. Next slide, please. And one of the greatest cricketing talents in the West Indies, 8,032 runs, 235 wickets and 109 catches in 93 tests. Can anyone tell me whom I'm referring to? The greatest all-rounder perhaps in West Indian cricket and world cricket. He was batting left-handed, he could bowl fast, he could bowl medium pace, he could bowl leg spinners, he could bowl the Chinaman. He was electrifying in the field at point and gully as a fieldsman. Well, Srikanth Bhandari gets it right. It is Sir Garfield Sobers. Gary Sobers was knighted at the end of his cricketing career in 1975. But due to a cruel irony, he could not bend properly to be knighted by the Queen because he had by then developed arthritis. He achieved the greatest feat of hitting six sixes in a single over. And that video will be shown here. Video, please. This was playing for Hampshire against Glamorgan at Swansea in 1968. In fact, if you watch carefully, you will observe that in one of the deliveries, Sobers gives a catch to long on, but in his anxiety to take the catch, the fieldsman oversteps the boundary, and this leads to it being awarded a six by the umpire. And meanwhile, you can think over it, try to think who was that hapless bowler whom Gary Sobers hit for six sixes in an over, and who was so downcast that he refused to pose for a photograph with Sobers and the ball after the match. Well, those were a few of the six sixes that you saw. This is, of course, Tony Cozier, the noted West Indian commentator, commenting on it. Well, Vinod Rajamani seems to be the first to the draw, as they would say in the Wild West. He has rightly identified the bowler as Nash. It is Malcolm Nash, the hapless bowler whom Sir Garfield Sobers hit for six sixes. The left-arm spinner, Malcolm Nash. It is Ganesh Prasad, just a correction. It's not Malcolm Nash, it is Malcolm Nash, okay? And this Vijay Kumar Shetty gets it right. It's M-A-L-C-O-L-M, Malcolm Nash. I guess Vijay Kumar Shetty must be my good friend and my financial consultant also. He advises me whenever I need advice. I hope it is him. He was my classmate. We used to sit on the same bench together. Yes, so those were the six sixers of Gary Sobers. Next slide, please. Okay, we have, yes. The year 1975 saw the dawn of the Limited Overs Cricket World Cup in England. Limited Overs Cricket had begun in 1971 in England and was gradually gaining popularity. And so the ICC thought of introducing a Limited Overs World Cup among all the test playing nations. The Prudential Insurance Company was roped in as a sponsor for the first three World Cups. The first World Cup in 1975 saw Australia and West Indies in the finals. West Indies were 50-3 when the West Indies captain Clive Lloyd walked out to bat. And he was facing the formidable Australian pace bowling pair of Thompson and Lilly. And Clive Lloyd went on to make 102 of 85 balls. And in fact, one English journalist described it as civilized butchery on the cricket field. Such was the ferocity with which he pummeled the Australian fast bowlers Thompson and Lilly to all parts of the ground. Australia put up a very good start, chasing the target of 291. But then Vivian Richards on the field was electrifying. He did 4 runouts. And then the last batsman, Thompson, was also run out by the wicketkeeper Derek Murray, leaving West Indies victors by 17 runs. And Clive Lloyd was named man of the match. The second World Cup, 1979, again saw West Indies in the final, but this time playing the English cricket team. Well, there's a question from Mangalore ICI. The first 3 World Cups were all for 60 overs. It was not 50 overs. When the World Cup began, as long as it was played in England, it was 60 overs. Because the light conditions in England were such that it used to get dark late, so they could play 60 overs matches, okay? So the West Indies scored 291 and Australia scored 274 in the first final. Okay. Yes. Coming to the second final, West Indies batted first and were 99 for 4, including the dismissal of Clive Lloyd, the hero of the first World Cup. But then the men of the hour were Collis King and Vivian Richards. Collis King made 86 of 67 balls. And Vivian Richards made 138 not out, including an incredible last ball 6. Of the English bowler Mike Hendrick. You can see the video in YouTube where he retreats to the offside and hits Hendrick for a 6 over the leg side. And in reply, Brearley and Boycott, the English opening pair, started off well, but they were too slow. In fact, they made 129 for the first wicket, but took 38 of the 60 overs in doing so. And it was rumored that Clive Lloyd deliberately dropped the catch of Jeff Boycott to allow him to continue to bat slowly and make the task more difficult for England. So you see, sometimes strategy can consist not only in taking catches, but also in dropping catches. Okay. And then West Indies reached 286. And England, as I said, made 129 for the first wicket, but took 38 overs. So the subsequent batsmen did not have time to get set. They had to come and straight away start hitting. And who was the bowler? It was the tallest bowler in Test cricket, the 6'8" giant Joel Garner, in whose hand a cricketing ball used to look like a small lemon. And he took 5 for 38, and England were all out for 194, leaving the West Indies victors by 92 runs, a much more handsome margin this time. And Clive Lloyd was saying that he was looking forward to repeating a hat-trick in 1983, but he did not know what destiny had in store for him. Sri Hariholla, just a correction. Even the 1983 World Cup was played with 60 overs. It was in 1987 when the tournament moved to India. It became the Reliance World Cup that it was reduced to 50 overs because Indian light conditions did not allow for 60 overs. Okay, just a small clarification in response to your comment. Yes, here you can see Clive Lloyd introducing the Queen Elizabeth to his battery of fast bowlers. Just behind Clive Lloyd's shoulder, you can see Andy Roberts, 6'1". To his left, you can see Michael Holding, 6'3". Next, you can see Colin Croft, 6'4". And above them all, the 6'8" giant Joel Garner. And then at the edge of the frame on the right, you can see the shortest, but perhaps the most meanest of them all, Malcolm Marshall. So these were the battery of fast bowlers that Clive Lloyd employed in his space arsenal. Okay, next slide, please. Innovation. In the next slide, please, I'm going to show you the photo of a man whose surname evokes, you know, thoughts or memories of a warehouse. It has a commercial name, but we remember him for most of the innovations that were introduced in modern cricket, including the white ball, colored clothing, day and night matches, etc. Can anyone tell me the name of this gentleman? He didn't play cricket himself, but he was responsible for revolutionizing cricket in 1976. He asked for telecasting rights of all test matches in Australia. And although he offered 5 times more than the Australian Broadcasting Corporation, His offer was declined by the Australian Cricket Board because they said Australian Broadcasting Corporation, ABC, has been our long-standing partner. He then bid for the telecasting rights of the Australian team touring England in 1976. And when initially refused, he doubled the offer and got the contract. But he was so angry with the Australian Cricket Board that he formed the Rebel Series. He could not call it Test Cricket, so he called it Super Tests and recruited 57 of the world's best cricketers to play for him. And I can see several people giving the answers here in different spellings, of course. It is Kerry Francis Bulmore Packer of Australia, the media magnate, the owner of Channel 9. Okay, so he started this Rebel Series called World Series Cricket, okay, in which 57 of the best cricketers played. They were all banned from Test cricket by their countries. The Australian Cricket Board denied Packer the use of the cricket stadia in Sydney and Melbourne, Adelaide, etc. So he had to hold his super tests in football parks in Melbourne, for example, the Victoria Football League Park in Melbourne. But later on, he convinced the local administration of Sydney to allow him not only to use the Sydney cricket ground for his day and night matches, but even to put the floodlights up at the expense of the local administration. Such was his reach. Kerry Francis Bulmore Packer. Next slide, please. Some of his, you know, marketing highlights. There used to be a record released with a song, a jingle, "Come on, Aussie, come on." I'm unable to use it here because without the sound, it will not be effective. But I would suggest that you see it in YouTube. Okay. Many of the test cricketers used to wear the t-shirt "Big Boys Play at Night." You can see one of them here who would perhaps be anxious to forget it now, given his current image. It is none other than the Adonis of cricket, Imran Khan of Pakistan. Whenever Imran Khan used to play in Australia, there used to be a greater lady audience at the stadiums. And someone used to say that when Imran Khan played in Australia, there were more worried husbands than terrified batsmen at the crease. But he was a very shrewd cricketing captain, and he achieved his three objectives, that is beating India in India in 1987, beating West Indies in West Indies. He managed a drawn series in 1988, although he didn't win the series, and then winning the World Cup in 1992 in Australia before he retired. And in the last photograph, you can see the floodlights going on in one of the super tests. Okay. Yes, next slide, please. Another innovation in cricket was pinch hitting. Many people think that pinch hitting was introduced by Sri Lanka in the 1996 World Cup by the opening pair of Ramesh Kaluvitarana and Sanath Jayasurya. But there was one batsman who had already done pinch hitting before that, who was promoted in the batting order and asked to open the New Zealand innings by Captain Martin Crowe, who showed that pinch hitting could be done to devastating effect. Video, please. And try to identify this left-handed New Zealand batsman. He used the first 15 overs to devastating effect, clearing the infield. Well, I can see the answer here. It is, as Srikanth Bhandari says, it is Mark Greatbatch of New Zealand. He was a middle order batsman specially promoted up the order to open the innings by his captain to make maximum runs in the first 15 overs. And you can see him hitting Malcolm Marshall with rarely seen ferocity over the infield for a six. Okay. So that was another innovation of cricket. That is, in the first 15 overs where there are fielding restrictions, try to score maximum runs. Next slide, please. Coming to emotional intelligence, you know, in a very competitive environment, it's very important that people retain their cool, the players retain their cool and not get upset or carried away by the heat of the moment. They should remember Rudyard Kipling's poem, "If you can keep your cool when others are losing theirs, my son, you will be so much the better for it." Next slide, please. Next, please don't play the video, just wait, okay? Well, this video which I'm going to show you now is the third test at Melbourne between India and Australia in 1980. And it features Sunil Gavaskar. To appreciate what happened, you should understand the mindset with which Sunil Gavaskar had come into this last test. It was a three-test series, and the first test at Sydney, India had lost under his captaincy by an innings and four runs. He had scored 0 and 10, failure in both the innings. The second test at Adelaide had been narrowly drawn by India. Sandeep Patil had distinguished himself by scoring 174. But then Gavaskar again was a relative failure with 23 and 5. So when India came to the third test at Melbourne, they had to win the match even to draw the series. And again in the first inning, Sunil Gavaskar had failed, scoring only 10 runs, while his brother-in-law G.R. Vishwanath had scored 114 out of an Indian innings of 237. And in reply, Australia had made 419 and India were batting to save the match. And Sunil Gavaskar and Chetan Chauhan seemed to recover their old form, and they had put on 165 runs for the first wicket when this happened. Please play the video. Sunil Gavaskar was on 70. And you can see Dennis Lilly bowling. Dennis Lilly, in fact, appealed while Gavaskar strongly claimed that the ball had touched the bat before going on to the pad. And the umpire Rex Whitehead ruled Gavaskar out. As an angry Gavaskar was walking towards the pavilion, the Australians hurled some abuses at him, which made him angry. And we have no reason to doubt Gavaskar, because Gavaskar was known as a walker. If he felt that he was out, he would walk even if the umpire did not judge him out. So you can see here, Gavaskar was angered by the abuse hurled by the Australians, and he took the other batsman, Chetan Chauhan, also with him off the field. Now the laws of cricket say that during the play, if both the batsmen leave the field, the batting side is deemed to have forfeited the match to the fielding side. But fortunately, the presence of mind of the Indian manager, the manager of the Indian cricket team, Wing Commander Shahid Durrani, saved the day. He made sure that Chetan Chauhan didn't come off the field. He allowed only Gavaskar to come off the field and sent the next batsman, Dilip Vengsarkar, in, which ensured that India did not forfeit the match. In retrospect, that was a very wise decision, because India made 324. Setting Australia a target of 143 in the last innings to win. And Kapil Dev bowling heroically despite an injured hamstring took 5 for 28 and Australia were dismissed for 83. Greg Chappell, the Australian captain, dismissed for a second ball duck by the Indian left-arm bowler Karsan Gowrie. So this was a rare moment where Gavaskar lost his cool, but the presence of mind of the manager saved the day. That's why we say that emotional intelligence is very important. Had Gavaskar allowed Chetan Chauhan to come off the field, India would have in fact lost the test match, which they eventually went on to win and draw the series. Next slide, please. Well, this is the pits of cricket, you know, and who else could have done it but the Australians? The Australian captain Greg Chappell, speaking to his brother Trevor Chappell, needing 235 to win, New Zealand were 229 for 6 with one ball to go. One delivery to go in the Benson and Edges World Series Cup final at Melbourne in 1981. And to the horror of the crowds and the administrators, Greg Chappell ordered his brother Trevor Chappell, to bowl the last ball underarm on the ground that the rules of the Benson and Edges tournament did not expressly prohibit underarm bowling. In other words, they did not say that the bowling should be overarm. That was a very, very poor exploitation of a loophole in the cricketing laws of the tournament, and you can see the underarm ball being bowled here. The New Zealand batsman is Brian McKinney. To his credit, the Australian wicketkeeper Rod Marsh protested and shouted out, "Don't do it." But then Greg Chappell was determined, and the last delivery was bowled underarm. It's very surprising that with such a background, the Indian cricket board chose this man to be the coach of the Indian cricket team. But then Sourav Ganguly put him in his place. Okay, thank you. Next slide, please. You see now the 1996 World Cup match between India and Pakistan at the Chinnaswamy Stadium in Bangalore. Pakistan were chasing 289 to win and seemed to be coasting along at 109 for one. And you can see Venkatesh Prasad bowling to the Pakistani batsman Amir Sohail. Yes, please. Please play the video. That's Amir Sohail pointing out to the bowler where the next ball would be hit. And the result, he was clean bowled of the very next ball. Had he cut out the histrionics and just concentrated on his batting, probably he would have taken Pakistan closely towards victory. But then he was determined to show his acting prowess on the cricketing field at the cost of his wicket. Next slide, please. Mangalore ICI rightly identified it before the clipping was shown as Venkatesh Prasad versus Amir Sohail. Coming to inspirational leadership. Next slide, please. Can anyone identify the man on the right? The man whom Ian Botham said was the only captain who could inspire him to do great things on the cricketing field. He described himself as having a degree in people. He has a degree in psychology, by the way, and now he is a very highly paid speaker on the international motivational speaker circuit. No answers. Well, his name was Michael Brearley. He was a very astute leader, and two instances show how astute a cricketing captain he was. The first was in the fourth test at the Oval between India and England in 1979. Now, Sunil Gavaskar had come into that test match with a fairly good string of scores. In the first test at Edgbaston, he had made 61 and 68. In the second test at Lord's, he had made 42 and 59. In the third test at Headingley Leeds, he had made 78. But in the first innings of the fourth test at the Oval, he had been dismissed cheaply for 13, caught behind by wicketkeeper Bob Taylor of Ian Botham. And it seemed that the Indian run machine was running out of steam. England made 305. India were dismissed for 202. With a 103-run lead, England batted again. And Brearley delayed the declaration till 334 for 8. To set India a target of 438. Other captains would have been satisfied with a target of 400, but remembering what India had done in Port of Spain in 1976, Brearley delayed the declaration and set an extended target of 438 for India. And in the end, that was the sole factor that denied India a victory. Sunil Gavaskar, playing perhaps the best innings of his life, scored 221 before being caught by David Gower off the bowling of Ian Botham. Along with Chetan Chauhan, he put on 213 for the first wicket, eclipsing the previous record of Vijay Merchant and Russi Modi set way back in 1936. India were 366 for one at one stage, and an umpiring mistake by Dickie Bird led to G.R. Vishwanath being given out wrongly, and eventually India ended at 429 for 8, just 9 runs short of the victory target. Had Brearley just set India 400 or 410 to win, India would have gone on to win. So that was one example of the intelligence of Michael Brearley. The second was in the Headingley test at Leeds in 1981. As I mentioned, when England were following on against Australia and were 174 for 6, Brearley sent out a message to Botham, don't worry about the match, play your natural innings and hit as much as you can. Botham hit out and made 149 not out. England made 356, and Australia had a target of 129 to win in the last innings. They were 56 for one when Brearley threw the ball to Bob Willis and not to Ian Botham, who had taken 6 for 95 in the first innings. He told Willis, bowl as fast as you can, don't worry about no balls. Inspired, Willis took 8 for 43, dismissed Australia for 111, and an 18-run victory was the result for England. Truly cricketing captaincy at its thinking best. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. The year was 1983. Having played a test series in England, in the West Indies in 1982, the Indian cricket team arrived to participate in the third Prudential World Cup. It was a team made up of multi-skilling talents. You can see in the front row, I'm sure most of them, you would identify them, Dilip Vengsarkar, wicketkeeper Syed Kirmani, Kapil Dev, Ramlal Nikanj, captain, Mohinder Amarnath, Sunil Gavaskar, Madan Lal. In the back row, standing from left to right, P.R. Mansingh, manager, Yashpal Sharma, Krishnamachari, Srikanth, Balwinder Singh, Sandhu, Ravishankar, Jaideep Shastri, Sandeep Madhusudan Patil, Roger Michael Binney, Kirti Bhagwajja Azad. And finally, the last player on the right is one who never played a single match in the tournament. Can anyone tell me who is that player who featured in the winning World Cup side of 1983 but never played a single match? By the way, Mini Vijay has given the correct answer for the previous slide. I did not notice it, so I will acknowledge it now. It is indeed Michael Brayley. Yes, can anyone tell me the name of that cricketer standing extreme right who never played in the entire World Cup? No, not Venkatapathi Raju. Venkatapathi Raju came later. No, I don't see the answer coming. It is the left-arm pace bowler Sunil Walsa. Okay, India began the tournament with a spectacular win over defending champions, the West Indies at Trent Bridge. But then later on, they went on to lose a couple of matches, one against the West Indies, where Dilip Vengsarkar's jaw was broken by Malcolm Marshall, thus rendering him unfit for the entire tournament, and also against Australia, where Trevor Chappell hit 100. So India went to play on June 18th. Against Zimbabwe at Tunbridge Wells. And that was a match which they had to win to stay in the tournament. And let us see what happened that day. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Okay. India batted first and were reduced to 9-4 when the captain Kapil Dev walked out to bat. Very soon it was 17-5. But then Kapil Dev was determined to make it his day and India's day. He scored a beautiful 175 not out of 138 balls with 16 fours and 6 sixes. His innings of 175 not out took India to 266 for 8. And he eventually they dismissed Zimbabwe for 235 to win the test match by 31 runs. Kapil Dev also took 1-32 with the ball. Having survived in the World Cup, they went on to beat Australia in the next match, the last qualifying match at Chelmsford by 118 runs, beat England by 6 wickets in the semi-finals. And on June 25th, 1983, which was a Saturday, I remember it very much, they went on to play West Indies in the final at Lord's. The West Indies had already purchased champagne to celebrate their victory because they were so confident of winning. But they did not know what was due to happen. Yes, Ganesh Prasad reminds me of a very important point before we go to the next slide. There is no recorded video footage of Kapil Dev's innings of 175 not out. We have to rely only on photos because on that day, June 18th, the BBC TV crew were on a strike. So there is sadly no recorded footage. Video footage of Kapil Dev's innings of 175 not out. Thank you, Ganesh Prasad, for reminding me of that little bit of trivia. Okay. Yes. So India batted first and made 183 all out. Sunil Gavaskar, within the first half an hour, was caught behind by wicketkeeper Geoffrey Dujon off the bowling of Andy Roberts. Krishnamachari Srikanth made an electrifying 38 but was LBW to Malcolm Marshall. Mohinder Amarnath made 26 but was bowled down the hill and through the gate with a beautiful Yorker by Michael Holding. Madan Lal's useful 17 and Syed Kirmani's 14 and Balwinder Singh's 11 not out towards the end of the innings took India to 183. And the West Indies were already celebrating, the crowds were beating the drums. But then after the lunch break, as the team went out, Kapil Dev urged his team. He said, "Let us make one last desperate effort for glory. We have nothing to lose." West Indies began the innings. Gordon Greenidge, for some strange reason, shouldered arms to a delivery from Balwinder Singh Sandhu, which looked like an outswinger, but midway became an inswinger and took his off stump. He was bowled for one. That brought in Sir Vivian Richards to the crease. And Vivian Richards started batting as if he wanted to finish the match in 15 overs and go home. He had made 33 of 28 balls when the turning point occurred in the match. Video, please. West Indies were 57 for 2 when this happened. The bowler is Madan Lal, and you can see Vivian Richards hitting him towards mid-wicket. And Kapil Dev led by example, a beautiful running catch at mid-wicket to dismiss Vivian Richards and make them 57 for 3. Cricketers would appreciate it's a very, very difficult catch to take because he was running forward, looking backward up over his shoulder, trying to see where the ball would come down and take the catch. This was the turning point of the match, leadership by example by Kapil Dev. But then all was not over. West Indies reached 76 for 6, but then wicketkeeper Jeffrey Dugan and Malcolm Marshall put on a 43-run partnership for the 7th wicket, and at 119 for 6, the match seemed to be slipping away from the West Indies. But then the Indian captain Kapil Dev had another brilliant inspiration. He threw the ball to his vice-captain Mohinder Amarnath and asked him to start bowling his gentle medium paces. With his very first delivery, Mohinder Amarnath clean bowled Jeffrey Dugan. He went on to claim the wicket of Malcolm Marshall as well, caught brilliantly by Sunil Gavaskar in the slips. Kapil Dev came back to trap Andy Roberts' LBW at 126 for 9. And then you see the final moment, the magic moment. It was at 12:35 a.m. on June 26th Indian time. I remember because I was sitting awake listening to the radio when this happened. We didn't have TV, of course, in Mangalore at that time. You can see this moment, 12:35 Indian time, June 26th. Mohinder Amarnath traps Michael Holding LBW. The West Indies are all out for 140. And you can see Kapil Dev proudly receiving the Prudential World Cup. The West Indian era had ended and the Indian era had begun. And please remember, this victory can be cited mainly to two reasons. That the two evils which later on haunted cricket were both not conspicuous by their presence during this tournament. One is the bookies. You did not hear of them throughout the tournament. The second one was these advertising and marketing people, you know, who used to convert cricketers to brand men. You would see that the Indian cricketers didn't have a single logo anywhere on their body. They used to wear the traditional white cricketing flannels. So without being bothered either by the bookies or by the advertising and marketing people, the Indian cricketers produced their best ever performance. Yes, next slide, please. But then by 1985, Indian cricketing fortunes had slipped to a low. And then Sunil Gavaskar led the Indian cricket team to Australia to participate in the Benson and Hedges World Championship of Cricket, which was being held to commemorate the 150th anniversary of the Victoria's Yachting Cup. And once again, India stunned the cricketing world. They beat Pakistan by 6 wickets in the first match, 86 runs victory over England in the second match. Third match, they beat Australia by 8 wickets. Fourth match, they beat New Zealand by 7 wickets. And in the finals, they beat Australia by 8 wickets. Sorry, they beat Pakistan by 8 wickets to win the World Championship of Cricket. A great lesson in management that you can always bounce back from being written off, provided you have the focus. Sunil Gavaskar led India very brilliantly. You know, he studied video footage of all the opposing batsmen. And whenever he won the toss, he made India field first so that they knew what they were chasing. He dropped himself down the order and promoted Ravi Shastri to open the tournament with great success. 182 runs and 8 wickets, and he won a golden Audi car for being adjudged the champion of champions. And above all, Sunil Gavaskar in his book Runs and Ruins confesses that in the final match against Pakistan, they deliberately did not go to bowl Pakistan all out before lunch because that would have led the Indians having to play 3 or 4 hours of bowling from Pakistan, that is Imran Khan and Abdul Hafiz, before lunch. And they would have gone all out to claim an early wicket. And the loss of an early wicket would have put India at a disadvantage. So great leadership and great team spirit and a great management lesson from India's victory in this tournament. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. From there, India went on to the Rothmans Cup. And Shastri walked out swaggering as the champion of champions to the first ball of the tournament from Imran Khan. India playing Pakistan in the first match and within 2 minutes walked back to the pavilion again, LBW of the very first delivery of the innings to Imran Khan. Mohammad Azharuddin scored 47, Kapil Dev scored 30, and at 125 all out, India seemed to have already lost the match. But then, as they say in management, never predict the end till the end comes. Pakistan slipped to 87 all out with the help of 4 brilliant catches by Sunil Gavaskar and inspired bowling by Kapil Dev, Ravi Shastri and Lakshman Shivram Krishnan. And 125 was too big a total for Pakistan, and India won. So the point is, it's not the target or what you are defending that counts. It is the spirit. Never say die till the last bullet is shot or till the last ball is bowled. Next slide, please. Yes. And here you see another interesting moment, the NatWest final between India and England in 2002. Yes, I can already see Mangalore ICI mentioning it. It's Flintoff bowling the last over of the tournament. Yes. Video, please. And here you can see Sourav Ganguly's famous gesture of taking off his shirt and waving it. Contrary to what you may think, it was not an impulsive or emotional action, but a very, very calculated action. Because after beating India in the last one-day international at Bombay earlier in 2002, the same year, Andrew Flintoff of England had mockingly taken off his shirt and waved it before the crowd. So it was a beautiful way of pointing out that India can give back as good as it gets. The heroes of that match were, of course, Mohammad Kaif, who scored 87, and Yuvraj Singh, who scored 69, as correctly pointed out by Naveen Kumar K. Thank you, Naveen, for pointing it out. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Yes, this you see the final of the T20 World Cup 2007. Again, very cool leadership by Mahendra Singh Dhoni. Pakistan just needed 6 runs to win, and you can see this clipping. Please play the video. It's Misbah ul Haq facing the last over by Joginder Sharma. In fact, Dhoni had handed over the ball to Joginder Sharma to bowl the last over in preference to Ashish Nehra and Harbhajan Singh. That was a very calculated decision which paid off, as Misbah ul Haq gave a catch and eventually India emerged the winners. Great leadership, great captaincy. Next slide, please. Again, Mahendra Singh Dhoni's inspiring leadership, captaincy. In the final against Sri Lanka, chasing 277 to win, Mahendra Singh Dhoni promoted video, please. I think there was some connectivity problem. Video, please. That is Mahendra Singh Dhoni finishing off the innings in grand style with 6 to win the 2011 World Cup for India. But in my personal opinion, it was no patch on the 1983 win, because the opponents were much more formidable in 1983. Yes. Next slide, please. Coming to ethics. Yes, next slide. The West Indies rebel cricket team that toured South Africa in 1982. South Africa was still under a ban, and they played big money to the West Indies cricketers to tour South Africa to play a rebel series. They were all, of course, banned from test cricket by the West Indian Cricket Board. But amidst this, there were some glorious examples. Clive Lloyd and Vivian Richards were both offered blank checks by the South African Cricket Board to be part of the rebel team, but they refused. Vivian Richards described the offer made to him as But many cricketers declined the offer despite being offered big money. That proved that ethics is very much alive in Test cricket. Next slide, please. This is the shame of cricket. You know, the scepter of match fixing that now haunts cricket. You remember the famous handkerchief, which was supposed to convey more than intended on the part of the bowler whenever he put it out of his pocket when he was bowling. You also see Bob Woolmer, the Pakistani cricket coach, who supposedly died of natural causes, but most people doubt it and believe that he was a victim of match fixing. Match fixing can in fact be described as the shame of cricket. And I have been personally dissuaded from following cricket since the late 1990s after we heard of matches being fixed, because you can never be sure whether what you're seeing on the field is a genuine performance or a carefully pre-scheduled one. In fact, match fixing is not new to cricket. In 1800s, there was an instance where, you know, the best bowler of one team and the best bowler of the best batsman of the other team were both bribed by bookies. And the bowler was trying his best not to make the batsman out, not to dismiss the batsman. And the best batsman was trying his best to get out. So you had a situation where both the batsman and the bowler of one team had been, of opposite teams had been fixed. Okay, next slide, please. Yes, from sport to war. Next slide, please. Yes, now with the 15 overs cricket, you know, the T20 is coming in, or even lesser, you know. Now the premium is on fitness, power and agility, and on a dynamic strategy approach, which often changes from over to over. So the strategy has completely changed. Next slide, please. Yes, again, emphasis on fitness, power and agility. Yes, next slide, please. Coming to the back office, you know, the people behind the scene are as important as the people in front. Okay, we'll show you some of the people who silently contribute to cricket, because even in management, we say that back office or operations is as important as front office or customer serving role. Next slide, please. You have the BBC radio cricket team. I used to love listening to them for their flawless English from left to right, top to bottom. John Arlott of BBC, Christopher Martin Jenkins of BBC, Trevor Bailey of BBC, and Brian Johnston of BBC, Fred Truman, former English cricketer who later became a BBC commentator, and then Alan McGillray of Australian Broadcasting Corporation. In fact, Christopher Martin Jenkins, when he bid goodbye after a glorious career in cricket commentating, he had a felicitation by BBC to which his wife was invited. And then in his farewell speech, he asked his wife, "My dear, did you imagine in your wildest dreams that you would see me being felicitated?" And the wife's reply was, "Who said that you feature in my wildest dreams?" So in a lighter way, of course. Okay, next slide. You have the Channel 9 team, Richie Beno, whom you saw earlier, Bill Laurie, the former Australian captain, Keith Stackpole, the Australian cricketer, Ian Chappell, and the West Indian Tony Cozier. This is the Channel 9 telecasting team. Yes, next. Next, please. You have great cricketing writers at the top. Sir Neville Cardus, perhaps the greatest cricketing writer that ever lived. Jack Fingleton, Australian cricketer turned writer. The two umpires, Harold Dickey Bird, who stood for 66 tests, and David Shepherd, who stood as umpire for 92 tests. Next slide, please. And then you have the people who captured great moments for posterity through their magic lens. You have Patrick Eager, the greatest cricket photographer who covered over 325 tests. You can see one of his photographs to his right. And then you have Adrian Muriel of All Sport, who also took some excellent and brilliant photographs, one of which you can see to the right. Next slide, please. Well, as we draw towards the close of my presentation, I would like to remember Raju Bharathan, who passed away this year. He was a cricketing encyclopedia and a music encyclopedia. He was the sports editor of Illustrated Weekly of India, and I used to be his very avid reader when to develop my cricket knowledge. As we draw to the close of my presentation, I will just conclude. Can you show the last slide, please? I've listed my references here. Cricket is, as I had mentioned in the beginning, it is many things to many people, and its sheer unpredictability continues to make it fascinating from a management perspective. Let me give you one last example. In the 1982 test at Port of Spain, when Sunil Gavaskar was due to bat, a cricketing enthusiast put a bet that Sunil Gavaskar will score more in Port of Spain than the West Indies opening pair combined. And the West Indies opening batsmen at that time were Gordon Greenidge and Desmond Haynes. So you can imagine what an ambitious bet it was. India won the toss and elected to bat. And within half an hour, Sunil Gavaskar was out, caught behind by wicketkeeper Geoffrey Dujon of the bowling of Michael Holding for only one run. India were all out for 175, and during the lunch break, the cricketing fan left the Port of Spain cricket stadium because he felt that Gavaskar, having scored only one, he had lost the bet. So he paid the money to the bookie, whatever he was due to pay for losing the bet, and set off home in his car. On the way, he switched on the radio to know what was happening. By then, the West Indies innings had begun, and he was shocked to hear that Balwinder Singh Sandhu had dismissed both Gordon Greenidge and Desmond Haynes for zero, which meant that he had won his bet. Sunil Gavaskar, though he scored only one, had scored more than the combined scores of the West Indies cricketing opening pair. He rushed back to the stadium, but the bookie had vanished, and legend has it that he was never again seen at the Queen's Park Oval Cricket Stadium in Port of Spain. On that note, I would like to conclude this presentation. Thanks to all the intellectual leaders for a patient viewing and listening. I have listed various books which you might be interested in reading. You can just see there the sources for my presentation. And thank you very much. And if there are any questions through the chat, I would be glad to answer them. Any questions on the chat, I will be glad to answer them. Well, Anil is asking any mention of Suresh Saraiya. Well, I have not mentioned some of the other commentators like Fredan Divatre or Narottam Puri or Suresh Saraiya, or, you know, even V.K. Chakrapani. You would remember the Indian born who migrated to Australia and became a leading commentator on Australian Broadcasting Corporation. Well, several commentators are there. I just mentioned these BBC and Australian Broadcasting Corporation and Channel 9 because most of my time I spent listening to them. Okay. But thank you for reminding me of Suresh Saraiya and the Indian team. Dr. Narottam Puri was a great commentator from India. Any questions?
That's it, sir.
Hello.
Yes, it's audible, Chairman sir.
Yeah, this is appearing on screen, Rajesh. Can you brief some matches?
Ten wickets in an innings. See, I have taken examples where I could link it to some management lesson. You know, Jim Laker took 19 for 90 in the Oval Test in 1956, including 9 for 37 and 10 for 53. That is a record which will never be surpassed in test cricket because it would require the person breaking the record to take 20 wickets in a test innings. But I have not mentioned it because I didn't have a specific link to management, you know. So test cricket is so fascinating. You know, it was born in 1877 at Melbourne, and so it is 143 years old. So you would appreciate that it's very difficult for me to cover 143 years in 1 hour, you know. For every example that I have given, cricket lovers here would have 10 other examples which I have not been able to cover. I just crave your indulgence, you know, in my limits. Okay. Definitely, I appreciate your feedback. Okay. Yes.
So we have.
Hey, you watch all the movies, you watch all the cricket matches. You have succeeded in all the exams with the first rank. What is the secret of your success?
Well, CSS Naik, as usual, has bowled a googly, perhaps more deadlier than the one which Eric Hall is bowled to Bradman. Well, I can only try to say the principle is knowing when to switch on and switch off. You know, the principle of balance is very important. I'm sure many CAs here would also be cricket lovers and music lovers. You are a prime example. But then you have balanced everything. You know, you are in so many fields and managing to make a success of all of them. I'm sure you'll agree with me that balance comes.
So we have a viewer.
What is the secret of your memory? I don't know. I guess it's God's grace and elders' blessings. That's all. I cannot really unravel, or to date, I do not know what is the secret of my memory. Thank you anyway, Athota Chennaiah, for that very kind question.
Some nail biting finish, some matches, can you brief?
Yes, I am seeing a comment from my dear classmate and close friend, Vijay Kumar Shetty. He has spoken some very kind words, and I am very honored because, you know, feedback from him I always value. You know, CA SS Naik and CA Vijay Kumar Shetty have been my dearest friends in the CA fraternity. So his feedback I always value. Thank you very much, Vijay, for your feedback, and also to your son Ronak. Okay, thank him for his feedback also. Okay. Yes. Well, Girdhar Kamath has really come up with a Chinaman. The Chinaman is the opposite of a googly. Any idea why underarm bowling is preferent in Mangalore area only? Well, I can give a humorous answer. I must confess, I do not know the answer. You would remember that in Tulu, underarm bowling is called Tarai bowling. And you know, Tarai is a very popular fruit in Mangalore. So I guess that's why, you know, underarm bowling is prevalent in Mangalore area. I used to play it a lot before, you know, in the stadium every Sunday between 6 and 8:30, we used to play Tarai cricket. Any other questions?
I think we are done with all the comments in the chat box. I request our chairman to give a few concluding remarks.
Well, Girdhar Kamath has added another brilliant one. He says Surnoli in Konkani. So Surnoli, you know, GSB community is also prevalent in large numbers in South Kendra. So he has given another justification why, you know, underarm bowling is prevalent here. Thank you, Girdhar Kamath.
Can you please highlight the all management lessons which we can learn from all this cricketing history, all these highlights?
Well, you know, each slide I mentioned the lesson. You know, things like, you know, play with a straight bat, you know, follow ethics. You know, you have competitive spirit, but at the same time, don't deviate from ethics. You know, leadership, how you have to play a leader. Each person is a leader in his own right. You need not look for a leader outside. You are a leader. You know, you can take the right decision if you think both with the head and heart. You know, so many lessons I have given. I have taken nearly 1 hour 15 minutes to do that. If I were to start reciting them all over again, I think the viewers and listeners, you know, their mood would change. So I would not venture into getting into a repetition. I think I should stop speaking when people are asking why rather than why not, like Sunil Gavaskar did. You know, he retired after scoring an immortal 96 against Pakistan at Bangalore on a treacherous wicket at the age of 38. When people were asking why is Gavaskar retiring so soon, whereas Kapil Dev stuck around until he wanted to break that Richard Hadley's world record of 415 wickets. And he stuck around after that until people were asking, why is Kapil Dev not retiring? You know, I would like to be like Gavaskar rather than Kapil Dev when it comes to knowing when to stop.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
sir. Yeah. How a small country like Sri Lanka could win a World Cup against all the giants?
Well, one of the secrets was they did strategy. You know, they had pinch hitting. Kaluvitarana and Jayasurya were hitting beautifully in the first 15 overs. Arjuna Ranatunga was a very astute captain. You know, though he is very often ridiculed, you know, because they used to say Arjun Ranatunga never steps out of the crease. So somebody said, you know, instead of a cricket ball, bowl a hamburger, and Arjun Ranatunga will come halfway down the pitch to face it, you know. So, but he is a very astute cricketing captain. And
that you means
remember, yes, Australians had sledged the Sri Lankan team earlier when they toured Australia. So they had come with a revengeful mood that they wanted to win, and not only win, but beat Australia. Well, Girdhar Kamath has a question. Why cricketer's sons did not make it to the top? All I can do is quote one sentence. Genes do not guarantee genius. Okay,
correct.
Genes do not guarantee genius. Sir Arthur Conan Doyle was a brilliant writer. He wrote the whole Sherlock Holmes stories. But his son Adrian Conan Doyle could write only one book. When asked why, somebody said genes do not guarantee genius. Rohan Gavaskar could not become Sunil Gavaskar. Arjun Tendulkar is still trying to become Sachin Tendulkar. You know, so genes do not guarantee genius. I hope that answers your question, Giridhar Kamath.
What is your opinion about our local hero, KL Rahul?
Well, you know, we should be proud that a local person has made it big, you know. It is always good because I still remember for a very long time, nobody had made it big from Mangalore. Dayanand Kamath, just for your information, in the 1966 when West Indies toured India, Dayanand Kamath, the stylish left-hander, had played for South Zone against Gary Sobers' touring West Indies team in Madras, but he could never make it to the Indian cricket team. So, you know, one reason is that when you are in Bangalore, Bombay, etc., you catch the eyes of the selectors, which is not easy when you are in a Mofusil town. Even Rahul, I think he moved to Bangalore before he caught the eyes of the selector. So we should be proud that a local person has made it, and hopefully he has broken the glass ceiling, and in the coming days we will see many more cricketers from Mangalore in the Indian cricket team.
But one thing about Rahul I wish to mention he was my batchmate, in the sense we were in the same age, but he was in Aloysius. One of my classmates used to be a teammate in this Mangalore team way back in the under 13-15. Back then I remember my classmate saying that one day this Rahul will represent the country, and this is when we are about 2005 or 2006, I'm telling, that he will represent India. He had mentioned us then, and it was way back in 2010 when he had represented under 19 World Cup for India. That was when we were in the second year PUC. So he had that talent that was quite visible at the local area, but as you said that he had moved to Bangalore at the right time, we feel, and from there on it was only an upward march for him.
That's excellent. You know, in fact, I think your friend is very prophetic. He has predicted Rahul's rise much before everybody.
Way back. Sometime.
And I do not know your friend. Otherwise, I would have also asked him to tell me when COVID-19 will stop, you know. But unfortunately, I do not know your friend. So I can.
And one more thing regarding cricket and management.
Yes.
Now that it is lockdown, I had a chance to view this series called as the Test, that is done by the Australian team.
Okay.
That is based on the Australian team, wherein what we see from the outside world is purely cricket, wherein they come, they play and they go. But a lot of man management happens behind the screen, wherein you have a bunch of coaches who sit and who do all the working.
Yes.
That Test series has given us a proper outline as to how actually a match is played, because what is seen, the 6 hours that is seen, is only what is visible to the front eyes. But back end, there is another 6-10 hours they spend on just visualizing a batsman, one kind of a delivery, all those things. Wherein cricket and management has to go hand in hand in today's
day. Yes, they play videos of opposing players and try to figure out the chinks in their
armor. Their weakness.
Yes, and correct. Mr. Harihulla points out that I have not referred to Dravid in my presentation. Harihulla ji, you would recall that when I spoke about the Kolkata Test of 2001, which I described as one of the greatest fightbacks in cricketing history, I particularly mentioned VVS Lakshman and Rahul Dravid, you know, the wall. He epitomizes the best qualities of Indian cricket, both in personal conduct off the field and in his cricketing prowess on the field. Hats off to Rahul Dravid. Okay.
The real gentleman in cricket field.
Yes, yes. Even Sachin Tendulkar for that matter.
Yes, for that matter. True.
And Sourav Ganguly brought back respectability to Indian cricket after it had reached a new depth, you know. So all the three which spirit, we remember with gratitude.
The fighting spirit, what we call as a fight fire with fire, was all born after the Dada
era. Do back as hard as you get. No apologies. Yes. So I hope Harihulla ji now is satisfied that I have referred to Rahul Dravid, a great cricketer. Okay.
And an excellent coach, Dravid, as of now, because he is nurturing the younger talent at present in our country, coaching our under 19 and the A teams as of now.
Yes. And of course, he scored the largest number of test centuries to any Indian cricketer. He has even crossed Gavaskar.
Okay. Dr. Rajesh, we could not... it is a surprise how we spent 2 hours with your illustrious presentation, illustrious memory power, illustrious flow, and illustrious all scoring, all scores and statistics. You are, I think, human computer. Really, hats off to you. You have made our day today as a really excellent day, and for all the situations you have hit fours and sixes. I think there is no four. All the balls you have hit sixers, and all the balls while you are bowling, you have bowled the batsman. So hats off. Thank you very much for your excellent presentation and memory and mesmerizing all the viewers. Thank you very much. Mangalore ICA is grateful to you for your excellent rendition. And we hope when you come back to India, we will have some seminars for our members and students. Hope to see you soon. So stay safe. And thank you very much for all your 2 hours excellent presentation and time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, CSS Naik. It's always a pleasure to respond to your invitation. You are my mentor. And a special thanks to CA Gautam Pai, you know, the future of CA fraternity. Future in the sense, you know, he's very young still, though he's already qualified. So, you know, the future chairman of ICI Mangalore chapter, you know, he has been very patient with me. I've been shooting emails left and right at him. He has played, you know, very invaluable role behind the scenes in making this come become possible. Thank you very much, Gautam, for all your support behind the scenes. Wish you all the best.
Okay, you,
and when you become chairman, probably I'll have the pleasure of again, you know, renewing ties with you. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
To all our viewers, with this, we have come to an end of our webinar sessions for members of the lockdown period 2.0. As I said at the beginning, that we had planned this for this period specifically for the 2 weeks. And this was the 11th in all, starting with 8 technical sessions, 2 general sessions, and 1 for students that we have. And again, for students, we'll be having in the next 15 minutes, wherein CA Hariharan sir from Chennai will be guiding and motivating our students on a topic relating to exams as to what we need to do, the do's and don'ts and tips that he will share with the students. I request all our members to encourage the students to come online very soon, because the session will begin in the next 15 minutes. And also to Rajesh Naik sir for the wonderful presentation. I was more eager at the back end, answering most of the questions as and when it came up. The spontaneous replies, I couldn't hold back when it came to cricket. So thank you for that too. And a lot of knowledge updation today in terms of the olden era, the past era of cricket, be it the West Indies era, the Australian, and then the Indian era. Thank you to you too, as well as the chairman sir, for being with us. And with this, we'll formally conclude our webinar series for the members, and the students webinar series will conclude at around 1:30 this afternoon.
Yes, I thank all our viewers.
I thank all our viewers and subscribers for coming up in wonderful numbers. We have crossed almost 900 subscribers. Our views have crossed about 15,000 in the past 10 days. It has been excellent from what we thought and where we are now. Had we somebody had said that 900 subscribers and so many views, we would have said, "Paka, why not?" And today it has become a reality. We thank each one of you for supporting the brands and our initiative at this period of lockdown. Now that lockdown 3.0 is enforced, we'll see what can be done at our end. But for now, webinar series comes to an end today. On behalf of the brands, I request each one of you to stay at home, stay safe, and we'll follow the guidelines issued by the district administration strictly. Until corona goes, we wish all stay safe. Thank you, one and all, and have a great weekend. Thank you.
Thank you.